Hot is presented by Betano. The game starts now. Here are your hosts, Brent Wallace, Jason York, and Bobby Ryan.
Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to Coming In Hot. I'm Brent Wallace, alongside Jason York and Bobby Ryan. I just want to point out before we get going, fellas, as you guys are aware, there has been no nerd report, so I don't know how this show is going to play out. There's no pages. There's nothing. Good luck.
That's not good for us. We'll be off the cuff real quick.
What are you talking? Bobby's been doing notes all day from the driving range.
I was taking notes. All right. Hammered about 700 golf balls. Had a bite to eat. What a day.
Yeah, I know Yorkie's still fired up from last night, so we should get right to it. People are bent out of shape. The sky is falling, and the Sens are now done, basically. Right? That's basically what Twitter was last night, as it descended into a mess as Ottawa lost 5-0 to the lowly Chicago Blackhawks. But let's not be surprised here, should we? Yorkie?
You want me to go first? Well, first of all, one more guy tries to correct my spelling, he's blocked on Twitter. Is there anything worse than the spelling police on Twitter?
Yorkie is fired up.
Hey, you're lucky they didn't have Twitter when you were playing. You have to delete it at 3 o'clock in the morning so nobody notices for a day or two. You get death threats.
Oh, God. Hey, listen, I got death threats. I used to do this show called Ice Surfing, and I said a comment. I don't know. It was about Henrik Lundqvist. I was getting death threats from New York Rangers fans because I said something negative about Henrik Lundqvist. It went on for weeks. I had to start blocking people. But people were fired up, to say the least, last night. Hey, it's one game. Like, this was bound to happen.
Yeah.
You and I talked about this on Friday last week, Wally. These are games where Chicago did to Ottawa what Ottawa did to many teams the last 5 years. Win a game that you probably shouldn't have won, because, hey, number one, Stalock was red hot to start that game off. And they missed their chances. And then they started pressing. And then it got out of hand. It's hockey, man. That's what happens. It's there's going to be games like this. And that's why we're talking about this, Bobby, last week. Everyone's saying they're just automatically going to win these games. Well, it's not that easy. Like, the other team over there, they know their general manager has sold the farm, and half that team's fighting for jobs next year, trying to prove they belong in the league. So they ain't going to give up, and Luke Richardson is not going to let that team lie down.
Exactly. And on top of that, I don't think the expectations of what I'm guessing in Ottawa over the 20 games left, they were going 20-0. And like, you're going to drop a dud. You're going to lose a game you shouldn't. But you're also going to probably pick up a game somewhere along the way that you shouldn't have won. So it balanced itself out. It was a dud. The only problem is this, is that you're off till Thursday, so you're going to sit on this one a little bit. But they got a day of work to get, you know, you're probably a day off or a light day today travel-wise, because that's a late night going all the way out there. That being said, you know, the only problem with this is that they're on a four-game road trip in four tough buildings coming up here with four good teams. So and a couple teams really fighting for their lives. So they got their work cut out for them. But if you can manage 500 on this road trip, you had a good road trip. That's always a good Western swing, is 500. And then you go from there. You see where you're at.
Okay. Do we really need are we really going to get bent out of shape, though, on a loss? Like, take me through this game. At one point, I think the shots were 17-7, and the score was 3-0 Chicago on seven shots. Like, it's not like Ottawa showed up and didn't play. I think afterwards they just kind of, I'll say, I don't want to use the word gave up, but I think they were a little less interested.
Yeah. I think after you go down three and you realize you've only given up seven, it's deflating. It's a hard spot for the goalie to go in. You know, at that point in the game when he wasn't supposed to be playing. So no preparation really. It's the perfect storm to lose 5-0 to a team that's 30th in the league, right? Everything went right. Their goalie showed up. You know, G rang that one off the post, and then in the same shift had another opportunity in tight. If he scores there, you might be looking at a completely different end to the first period and a completely different score at the end of the first. And then, the snowball effect might not happen because, you know, Chicago's a team that you give them a lead, they're okay, they're loose, they're comfortable. But if they're in a tight game, the later in the game, that benefits every other team they're playing. They just never had that because Stalock shut the door. So it was a stress-free night for them and a very, very stressful day for Ottawa Sens fans today, apparently.
It was a late night for a lot of people.
I didn't make it. I got out. I was like, you know what? My alarm was set for 4:10 this morning to go to the gym. And I got up and did it. Yeah, I was not impressed when it went off, but I got up and did it. What? Where are you going to chime in?
Good on you,
this?
Bobby. Why? Good on you.
So just let me, just so I got this straight, you are a retired hockey player and you're getting up at 4:10 to go to the gym? Like, what am I missing? Is it just
severe dedication to the craft. you gotta stay committed. I'm trying hard not to look like a couple other guys that have podcasts that are retired.
Yeah.
I gotta keep it tight. I did eat a bowl of mac and cheese at 10:30. No kidding. Chris Schwartz would have told you I should have worked at a leg a lot of times during my 7. Yeah.
Do you regularly get up at 4 in the morning?
Not regularly, no, just kind of as the schedule. I would say once a week, but not always 4, you know, sometimes in the 5 and 6 range. But I get up early and get it done when I have to.
Good for you. Wow. Yeah. I'm rolling out of bed around 8 a.m. I'm an 8 a.m. kind of guy.
I like it. That's it. Yeah, I'm paying for it right now.
I was 8:30. Yeah. Oh, wow. You need a nap. So, okay, let's bring this back on the rails for a moment. Brady Tkachuk after the game had a quote, and he didn't seem, and as we remember, he got kicked out of the game with Kostelec and Watson. 5 minutes to go. He's like, not good. Unacceptable. I guess we took them lightly. I guess we forgot that that's where we were not too long ago. Is he just, I don't know, saying some words, or does it, if you're in the room, do you believe in what he's saying here? Is it unacceptable? Listen, you guys are all playing in the National Hockey League. It's not like every team is never going to win a game unless you're the 92-93 Senators. So my point is, they just played a team. They got beat. Is it really that bad?
So I'll tell you what. Ottawa, the last little while, has been playing with a lot of swagger, a lot of confidence, and they're playing like a team that thinks they're going to win and expects they're going to win. But there's a fine line where you can creep and get a little bit thinking it's just going to happen. And that's what I think happened to the Ottawa Senators last night. They went into this game. Because Bobby will tell you this, confidence is so important in this game. If you've got confidence, it's half the bottle. It's a mental game. Everyone in the league's a good player, but you get the confidence. But I just think last night, I just noticed a lot more loops, a lot less stopping on pucks. Where in the past, things were just happening organically. Everything they did worked. All their shots were going in. They were defending. And last night, this is what happened. I just think they thought it was going to be easy, and nobody goes into a game not trying as hard, but I just think they got to realize what's gotten them there. And that was paying attention to details, doing all little things right, stopping on pucks. And we're going to go over a game later. We have a clip in the game where the one goal, I counted four, I call them loop-de-loops, where you don't stop on the puck and you do a big loop. Way too many loops in this game, and then you just, before you know it, you're down, but that's hockey, man. It's an 82-game schedule. You're not going to be perfect every night. It's a mental battle. It's a physical battle, and last night they just weren't up to the task, and it's not that they didn't get some chances, didn't generate. I just thought defensively they took some shortcuts, they didn't stop on pucks, and they didn't pay attention to details, and that's why they lost.
Yeah, I agree. I call them the flybys, right? You fly by, take a swipe, and see what you get. Or at least that's what all my coaches called it when I did it. But they because I mean, Ottawa is a skilled team, but they're not going to outskill a lot of teams one through four lines, right? And I think that last night you can look at that roster and they're all looking at it going, we can do that tonight. But they, again, you, when you do that, you forget to pay attention to detail. You forget to put your work boots on. So that's all it looked like. I don't think they didn't work. I you know, they carried the pace of that first period for a lot of it, for me anyway. Stalock just shut the door, a couple posts, and the game turned. You know, they score on that, they score that first goal towards the end of the first, and you know, now you guys, I noticed that. I thought that they were cheating offensively quite a bit, getting ahead of the puck way too much in the early part of the second, when I at which point I turned it off, and I'm glad I did, because it would have been nauseating.
Wally, do you want to do that video now? We're going to save that.
Sure. Okay. Before we do that, it's sponsor read time. So
yes.
Do you guys, would you like to pick your sponsor read for, I have to do them all today?
Do one.
We'll I was going to say, if we're not getting a nerd report, I don't know what you're bringing to the show today.
Basically, I'm kind of packing it in. It's an off day.
Okay. Yeah. That's fair.
Yeah, no, it's an optional.
No problem.
I'll
do it. Take it as option.
You know what? Yeah. Screw you guys. One. I'm doing them all. Nope.
All right. Let's see what a 10 looks like.
This show is always presented to you by Botano. Go to botano.ca, download the award-winning app. They are the EGR Company Operator of the Year in 2021. The game starts now with Botano. Online betting and casino and live betting. Don't forget that you can join in any of the games and pick and choose as you go along. So, Botano, the game starts now. By BEI, our good friends at Bonshire Excavating Inc., who are hiring basically in all positions. Give them a shout. Go to their website, bonshireexcavating.com, or call them 613-432-1120. They're looking for laborers, mechanics, concrete structure team, quality control technicians, all kinds. Bonshire Excavating, helping to shape the Ottawa Valley. Don't forget, Friday afternoons, they've got hockey. And by Renfrew Pro Tape, as always, this show held together loosely by Renfrew Pro Tape. Join them on Instagram for Free Tape Friday. With Renfrew Pro, you can feel the game. They're the ones with the green cord, by the way. If you're at all major retailers, it's not hard to find them. They're pro cloth tape, specifically designed for today's composite hockey sticks. Renfrew Pro. Go to renfrewpro.com, and you can also order them from amazon.com. There, gentlemen, that's how it's done.
See, I don't know about you, Yorkie, but he's got access to different shit that we do, because I don't know where half of that came from. The Amazon plug at the end.
This is
they're not paying us. Well, you don't need to throw Amazon in there. Okay, all right.
Yeah, well done.
All I got. I got the same.
Yeah, I give it a 9.
I happen to look up.
It was good.
Okay, 9.5. That's fair.
Yeah, it was good.
All right, so. Before we do Yorkie vids, which I'm going to have to make some kind of fancy animation for this, but I just have one question on Brady being chucked out of that game who wanted to fight Alex Stalock. I want you two to tell me what did Alex Stalock say that made Brady wanted to fight the goalie?
He probably said, "You guys suck and you're not making the playoffs. You're just as bad as us." Like maybe something like that. I don't know. What do you think, Bob?
I know Stalock a little bit. Whatever he said was good, because I went to World Junior Camp with him. He ultimately didn't make the team, but I thought he was hilarious. He had me in stitches for a week at that camp. So he got Brady pretty good here with something. I don't know. Anyways, he's got this little sarcastic pun the way he does things. So look at him. He's just calm, cool, and collected. Let me put the mask up. Yeah, yeah. And then that mask would be going down so fast if Brady got free. But
oh, boy.
That stick would have been in the rafters ready to swing if Brady got loose. Yeah. But I couldn't even venture to guess what really got him heated. I might have to send a good text and tell him I won't use it for the show.
Send him a text. We got to find out. We got to find out. Yeah. But I you know what? To answer your question, Wally, I love everything about this guy, Brady Tkachuk. This guy is – people are starting to take notice around the league too. I was watching some of the stuff saying, this guy's a great captain. Love him to be our captain. He cares, man. He cares. He wants the playoffs so bad. I loved what he said. You read the quote earlier, Wally. I think we forget that this was just our team a little while ago, what the Chicago Blackhawks are right now. So he's saying all the right things. And for me, Talk is cheap. Talk is cheap. I love a captain that goes out and does what he preaches. And does nobody does it as like this guy does. He's nobody's fighting at center ice at Madison Square Garden like Brady Tkachuk, running down defensemen, putting up points. I can't wait to see this guy when the Senators eventually do make the playoffs. He's the perfect captain for this club. And I always say this, man, the teams that picked in front of him must be kicking themselves right now. Like if you're the Montreal Canadiens, how did you not draft Brady Tkachuk? Like every time you want to see this guy play, it must be the biggest kick in the nuts every single time he plays against your team. Like what? Actually, what a drop of the ball.
Who went 1-2 that year?
Rasmus Dahlin and Sebastian. Svechnikov, I believe.
Svechnikov. Okay. Yeah. So
good players.
So 1 and 2 are great players. And Kotkaniemi is a good. I actually always thought he was really crafty, really good, like cerebral player out there when I played against him. But yes, Brady's your clear cut number three. So Montreal must absolutely hate it. You could not be more correct.
I agree with everything you said. So interesting debate. I know we're off topic. Andrei Svechnikov, 344 games, 111 goals, 263 points, 306 penalty minutes. Brady Tkachuk, 340 games, so four less games, five more goals, six less points, and 160 penalty minutes more, roughly. If you had to pick again, man, are you taking Andrei Svechnikov or Brady Tkachuk? And I know we're obviously a little biased because we watch Brady every game, but yeah, I'm thinking sure. I might take Brady Tkachuk based on all the other elements he brings.
I'm just saying for what Carolina needed and what Ottawa needed, it worked out the right way. Yep. I don't know that he's the play, and Brady's probably seen a lot more time on ice than him. I would be, because Brady got thrown right into it, where Svechnikov got in and he was a top six guy and you know all that. But he had some guys to play behind in some big areas where Brady had a few, but he was playing with Stoner right out of the gate. And he's been surrounded as well. But I just think the makeup of Carolina and Brady don't necessarily go to each other. They're a quick, speedy team, and that's a problem too. They lose in the playoffs at times because of that. They don't have that size or that physical element. So, outside of Jordan Staal. But I think both teams got what they needed, and I would still take Svech if I was picking there at that time for Carolina.
Okay.
And that's not a knock. You know, that's just kind of an assessment.
No.
Tough question. Svechnikov's such a good player. I could even make an argument for taking Tkachuk if you're buff. Like, you really can't go wrong with any of those players. Here's the thing. I could make the argument for Buffalo because Buffalo was rebuilding. They needed a guy to go in there and be a leader. It's just a perfect storm. Brady came in, got to live with Mark Stone, who is a good person, and got to watch how he goes about his business and works. So that was really good for him. And Brady still would have turned into what he's turned in. It's genetics. It's the family. It's how his dad raised him. But it's the perfect fit for Ottawa. They needed a big alpha that could come in and do what he's doing right now. And I think this argument will be best decided after we see him play in the playoffs, because I think playoff Brady is he going to be even better than regular season Brady when you're best of seven, every single game you're playing the same group of D. That's when we're really going to see it, guys. So I think we'll have a clear decision on this once we see Brady play playoffs, which I know what he's going to do. Like it's going to be fun to watch.
Yeah.
And the way that Bobby is now training, he might be back in the lineup for when Ottawa makes the next playoff push.
Yeah, not a chance. there's a lot of cobwebs on that Red Wings bag over there.
All right, back to the Chicago game where I have the stats from that game. Odd man rushes. Chicago had 92 in that game.
92.
Okay. Like, yeah. I guess we can go into it, but I don't even know how you say it. What do you say there? The boys were cheating.
How do you allow? Yeah. Yeah. So you explained to me as a professional hockey player how so many odd man rushes happened in the same game.
I would like to see how many happened after it was 3-0. That would be very, very telling, because that's when you know you're chasing.
DJ called a timeout. DJ called a timeout and said, no more odd man rushes. And I think within the next 30 seconds, they gave up 3.
And a breakaway. And a breakaway.
So he must have been beside himself behind that bench last night.
I would love couple things that Chicago did really well. They're the first team that I saw really pressure Ottawa's power play. They did a great pre-scout because they never let Ottawa get feeling real comfortable on the power play. They pressured them really hard. They still got some looks, but it's the most aggressive I've seen a team be on Ottawa. And again, that's a team that's loose and they're trying different things, and they went heavy pressure, and then they read that drop pass a couple of times. They knew it was coming and they picked it off. I think they had a couple of breakaways at least picking off the drop pass. So they had a good game plan. And, you know, to answer your question with how many, why was there 92 odd man rushes? Bad pinches, number one, and no high guy. That's usually what it is. D shouldn't pinch because he doesn't check his shoulder, and there's no high guy, and then you get a 2-on-1. It's as easy as that. No support.
Yeah.
Guy pinches, 2-on-1.
Yep.
They needed Nikita Zaitsev last night. I tried to tell this group.
Oh, yeah.
Revenge of
Zaitsev. Who did he bury? Oh, he absolutely flattened Gambrell behind the net in the first.
Yeah, he did.
Yeah.
Okay, anyway. Video time. We can do your video.
Let's see him.
Let's do it.
Yorkie Vid time, everybody.
Yeah.
We need a television sponsor for this.
Yeah, brought to you by Yorkie Chocolate Bars.
Panasonic.
That's a sensation. Oh, sorry. That's that's York Peppermint Patties. But can we go over this? Are we able to make this video a little bit bigger, Alex? Or is that as big as we're getting? There we go. So this, Bobby, I watched this a couple times this morning, and it was 4-on-4. And to me, it kind of signified the Sens game in a nutshell. Right here, it's only a 1-0 hockey game. Ottawa's out shooting Chicago 14-3 at this point. It's a pretty key moment in the game. It's 4-on-4. This should be to the advantage of the Ottawa Senators. And they probably think that too. Hey, we're a better team. It's 4-on-4. But this whole sequence, and Chabot takes a ton of heat. People who are all over him on Twitter, all over him for the game. And right off the bat here, he's going to get the puck, turns it over right away. So if you run it right here, Alex, right away, Chabot's going to turn the puck over to start the whole thing. And stop it there for a sec. To your point earlier, Bobby, they were really high, so they're just assuming Chabot's going to get that puck, make a good pass, too high. So it goes to Chicago, and then roll it here. Here's loop number one. Bobby talked about your flybys. There's DeBrincat. Nice little loop-de-loop. Yeah. And right here, stop it there. So 4-on-4. You're either going to sag back and protect the slot or go man-on-man. I don't know what Ottawa's doing, but this should be Chabot's guy. Yeah. But then... And then Claude Giroux kind of looks over too, and you get two guys going to one guy, and you've created a 2-on-1 right away. So it's just a little bit of a lack of communication, 2-on-1, and you saw DeBrincat second loop. And this is the play, right? Stop it right there. So again, there's two Senators on the boards here. Ottawa's already made 3 mistakes on this play. Now Giroux makes the contact, puck should be there. DeBrincat's just got to stop on this and get the puck out. Watch what happens again. Run it, Alex. Another loop. So it's and then Zub loses his guy on the 2-on-1. He goes to the puck. So many things happen on this play. And the thing I didn't like about it, everybody just blames Chabot. Yeah, he starts it all off, but there's so many things that Ottawa does on this play. And to me, it was kind of Ottawa's game in a nutshell. Just they thought it was going to be easy. A lot of loops, a lot of flybys, and you just can't give opportunities like this. These are NHL players. Doesn't matter if Chicago Blackhawks, you can't make it this easy.
No, so I lost a good – I was playing catch-up on that whole video and the audio for most of that time. But I'll say on the first play, Chabby gets kind of put on an island because whoever's supposed to bail – I think it's – Okay, he's on an island. G's got to come across. I think this is G. Yeah, G comes out to the point and puts himself in front of another guy. Brinkat's behind the net where he didn't start that play. He's got to be right where Chabby passed that puck, like, to me. And then it just turns in. And then, you know, you have numerous double ups. Right. Sorry, here's the pass. Then you got the Brinkat's flyby. And yeah, I couldn't agree more that this was the night. There's, you know, Zub kind of finishes this guy there. Chabby's got, can't go behind the net. G's got a sag here. Get out of the way. You have a one-on-one situation with Chabby following a guy up. So fold back to the center of the ice and the next guy will come to you. So there's 12 mistakes in 32 seconds of hockey here. You know, and your goalie's got a 10 beller on a 4-on-4. Like, it's hard to give up a great, and then Chabby goes running here, but Zub loses guy. So I said all the same things you did, I think, but it was just a cluster. It was a mess of a shift from, okay, Chabby's taken the most, but they all made a mistake. Every single player made a mistake on that shift.
And that's the thing with this game, Wally, just to finish off the thought, like this, when they made mistakes in this game, they were big mistakes. But this is what happens over the course of an 82 NHL game schedule. And people say, well, you can't do that in the most important game of the season. But the law of averages came into play for the Ottawa Senators. They've been so good. Things have been going their way. And then you kind of think they're just going to happen automatically before you. And then you start cheating. You start doing flybys. You stop. You don't do the little things, stopping on pucks, supporting plays, getting too high. So bad timing for this to happen, but just a little bit of the reasoning. To me, it's more a mental thing why this happened to the Ottawa Senators. But it's not. This was the whole team. They were due for a stinker. Have the stinker, flush it. You heard it. Yep. Get ready for Seattle.
Yep.
Okay. So two things. One, people want to know in the chat basically about them dwelling on this. I don't think they give, like, and I've talked to you guys after losses. Like, we'll be fine. We'll get at it tomorrow. Like, you guys don't spend a lot of time thinking about losing hockey games the night before, if I'm not mistaken.
No, I mean, you can't. You're going to, with 82 and then, you know, it averages the 3 a week, whatever it might be, you don't really have that time. You're going to take a lump the next day if you're one of the guys that he picks for video and singles out. And but no, honestly, I mean, by the time I was home most nights, I'd watch the highlights. I wasn't a big video watcher the night of. But I would watch the highlights of, you know, things. And then I went to bed not thinking about it. Knew that, you know, there were going to be mornings you come in and, like I said, you're going to hear about it. You're going to talk about it. But you're already, your next practice isn't about correcting things unless it's a systematic thing. You're going out there and you're already preparing by noon the next day for the next game and the next team, right? And a lot of times you're just there that next day if you're not playing, you know, if it's not a Monday, Wednesday game, you're just out there to flush it out, do some skill work, some systematic work, and you know, the game's over with, right? You're not thinking about it.
Yeah. I was a little bit different. I would take, if I played a game like last night and I was one of the main culprits, I couldn't let it slide until the next game, but then the next game I was fine. The next game, you can't bring it into the next game with you. And usually it's over too mentally by video time. Everyone gets called out. You watch the video. Coaches will choose some guys out and go over things, and then you move on. But no, I'd say a lot of guys probably went home, were pretty pissed off. I would say, judging from Brady's reactions, he probably didn't. You know, he's probably bitter for a while, but they'll wake up today, and you have to move on. You have no choice. Yep. Because mentally, if you carry over games like this, you're going to drive yourself nuts. And you can't do that as a pro.
Does it really matter if that's a 5-0 game or a 3-2 game at the end of the day?
No, not to me. You know, I don't think so.
I would think it's actually better, because things have gotten so good and almost easy for the Ottawa Senators that they need a reset. Because you needed to be embarrassed, because now DJ and the coaching staff can go and say, listen, this is what we need. And then you'll get their attention a little easier. So I think it's actually better, believe it or not, that you lost the way you did last night, because it's going to be a lot easier to get guys back in line.
Yeah, I can agree with that.
Do we have the Do we have the Jake Sanderson goal, if you will, from last night's game? And if not, Alex, it's okay. And I've seen it come up a couple of times in the chat about people are disappointed in the way Sanderson played that goal. The one where he is laying out for it, if you will. So, Yorkie, you can, I guess, give me your thoughts.
Yeah, yeah. Do we have the video?
If you guys have maybe done some previous work, we would have it.
Yeah, regardless, it's the toe drag. Was that Athanasio that pulled the toe drag on him there? Anyways, you got to play the percentages as a defenseman. And yeah, that was a fantastic toe drag. And you're almost like a helpless feeling as a defenseman. It's like you're tobogganing by, oh no. And then he just toe drags it around him. And then you're like, you're looking back, all right, please save this, please save this, please save this. And that's so good.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. It's like,
I can only tell you, I used to absolutely like, and you, Yorkie, what's the number one rule of thumb on a 2-on-1? Don't let the goalie get backdoored, right?
Don't get the goalie back. Yeah, he got the shooter. You make sure the pass doesn't get through. So it's, I used to hate it, man.
When guys slid, you had one option to pull that move and that move alone. And the guy nailed it. I mean, but I used to hate when D-man would slide. It takes away so many options. So I don't have a problem with it. Time it better. That's all.
I'll say this for Jake Sanderson. I say this all the time. Defensemen need to do a couple laps around the league before you get a handle on what certain guys can do, what everybody has in their toolbox. And next time he plays against that player, he'll know he has that one in his repertoire. Very few guys can pull that move off. I'll tell you right now. kind of toe. That was pretty slick. It was a great move. And sometimes you got to tip your hat to the other team. And you know what? That was pretty friggin' good. So I'm not going to shit on a rookie who's had a really good season for trying a desperation play at a split second moment when he thought it was the right play.
Yeah. Agreed.
Fair enough. Standings. Do we have the standings board, Alex? There's a couple of big games tonight, by the way, if you haven't checked the NHL schedule. I know the Islanders are playing off the top of my head now. Of course, I can't remember off the top of my head. Should have put it in the nerd report. The Sabres are playing the Islanders, right? So that's a big game for Ottawa. Buffalo makes up their one game they have in hand. So if the Islanders, I guess, can win that game, then Buffalo and Ottawa stay tied for points. But you give up the points to the Islanders. So that's an interesting game. What you don't want is obviously the 3-point game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And you got Columbus. You got to root for Columbus and Pittsburgh because you lost that game in hand, obviously. Florida's home to the Golden Knights. If the Golden Knights have been there for a couple of days, you got to hope the elbow room plays does its role here, Yorkie.
let's go elbow room.
You just don't want that's what you have to root for every night. Just 2 points going one way, and you know, not that other 1 point that stingy 1 point where happens all the time at this point in the year. You can't hope for any of those.
Look at Florida. They're sneaky right now. I didn't realize Ottawa only had one game in hand and they're tied. That's a team to keep an eye on because they have some big game players over there. So Florida to me, man, like we've been talking so much about Pittsburgh, so much about New York and Buffalo. Watch out for Florida. Like there's a lot of racetrack left for them along with Ottawa. This is going to be, I still think New York's the team. I think the way Buffalo plays, they're so loose.
Yeah.
And they try anything. So I think if one team's going to fall off, it's going to be Buffalo. But if New York doesn't make the playoffs, you'd have to think someone's getting fired there. Like the moves they made, bringing in Horvat for what they like, someone's head's going to be on a platter if New York misses.
Yeah, I think Florida's got a chance. Played. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree.
Florida's playing 500 hockey for like the last 2, 4, 6, 10 games.
Yeah.
12 games. But, they they haven't won two in a row since early February. They just don't seem to have it together at the moment.
They're due. They haven't peaked yet.
Maybe.
They're due.
That team could go on a run at any point. Any point, really.
Yeah. It's going to be interesting, but this Seattle game kind of scares me for the Ottawa Senators, just because Seattle's a team they're very similar to Vegas. They're built up of a bunch of guys who were third liners on other team, and they work and they skate, and they don't care about their cookies. They don't care who gets the credit. All they want to do is win and prove that the other teams shouldn't let them go. So that's not a great matchup for Ottawa. So I'm a little concerned for this one, Ottawa heading into that one.
Seattle, just for the record, 13 players with 10 goals or more.
Yeah. They just work.
You're getting balanced.
They don't cheat the game.
Yep. Yeah.
They don't cheat.
They've won four in a row, by the way. All on the road. They're just obviously must be finishing up a road trip, because they've won four straight on the road.
It's really annoying to play teams like that when you have to win games, because there's always certain guys, like let's say you're playing Pittsburgh. You know Malkin's going to cheat a little bit, and he's going to try things offensively. You know there's some guys that don't back check. Like if you're playing the Rangers, Panarin's not going to back check all the time. When you're playing Seattle, every single guy on that team is working his ass off. They don't give you an inch. And that's this time of year. Those are tough teams to beat.
Yeah, I agree. It's going to be
Now that the dust is kind of settled on trade deadline and players have now moved around and gotten into the action, has your Stanley Cup pick changed at all? And who you think may be going to emerge from each side to play in a Stanley Cup final?
I wouldn't say mine does, no. No, I still like Boston over Colorado.
Okay.
Yorkie? Yeah, that's interesting. When the season started, I didn't have Boston. I didn't see them doing what they're doing. They're a tough team to go against. I picked Colorado to win this year. I still like Colorado. I just think that with the injuries they've had this year, they've had star players out for a certain amount. I still like what they're doing. I believe it or not, I'm going to go against Boston, but it's going to be whoever the healthiest team is, whoever has the hottest goaltender at the time. So throw a dart.
Thanks, Tips.
I'll throw my dart at Colorado again, just because I think they still have the most talent.
So why doesn't anybody give Carolina any credit?
Good question.
Maybe it's because of where they are. They're just, they're always just a forgotten team on the schedule too, aren't they, Yorkie? When you look at the schedule every year, you're like, okay, we're going there for that one. I always liked the team. I just don't know if you get in the rounds, past that second round, if they have the size and they got a little bit more of it, but the size and the goaltending to really carry them all the way. Good goaltending, but not great goaltending. And I think you need that in rounds three and four.
Okay. That'll be my thing with Carolina too, Wally. I don't know if they got the goalies either. It's just, that's, could they? Absolutely. You go back to when Carolina won, when Cam Ward came out of nowhere and won. So you never know when lightning is going to strike in a bottle. The one thing I do love about him, I think Rob Brindamore is a heck of a coach, motivator. Guys love him. Guys love playing for him. He's a wild card. So could they do it? Absolutely. I just, goaltending's question mark for me. When you look at Carolina too, who's their real go-to guy there, Bob? When you look at the Carolina Hurricanes, like you want to win a game, who are you looking at on that team? Like, it's
a bunch of small guys, right? Aho, Svech. And then I love their blue line, but, I think Jordan Staal is a great playoff gamer, right? But, I don't know. They do it by committee, and sometimes you just need one or two guys to really, really elevate from a committee, and that makes it hard because they roll the line so well. They do everything. I don't know. I don't see it in rounds three and four.
Yeah. No, we'll see. Looking around the league right now, everyone's looking at Boston. Mathematically what they're doing, it's unbelievable. So they got to be the favorite. And then it always comes down to, and I feel like a broken record, who's healthiest, whose goalie's playing well, and who's third line. Because to me, third lines win you Stanley Cups as good as your best players are. Who's got the most depth? And, looking on paper right now, it is Boston.
Freddie Anderson, the former Toronto Maple Leaf goalie, doesn't do it for you in Carolina, is what you're telling me.
No. Doesn't ooze confidence of big. Because here's the thing. He's in Carolina. It's all cozy there during the regular season. There's no real people talking about hockey. There's not a lot of pressure. There is pressure, but there's nobody in your face every day there. And all of a sudden you get to the playoffs and you're on national television, and instead of having two reporters in your room, there's 200. There's a reason it didn't work for him in Toronto. Maybe he'll prove me wrong. He doesn't seem like a big pressure guy to me. And goaltenders, there's a reason they're crazy. There's a reason they're nuts. It's because they have an ability to be crazy and block out all that shit. The best ones are able to do that. And up until this point, Freddie Anderson hasn't proven to me that he can do that. Maybe he can this year, but until this point, I haven't seen him be able to do it. So until he does, that's the unfortunate part of evaluating goalies. He hasn't done it yet. So
okay, see, you're still negative. He, by the way, just shut out Tampa 6-0 in his last start.
Yeah, the tempo was terrible.
Out there.
Let's not hang your hat on that one.
Man, you guys are tough today. All right, so with that being said, we'll be back Thursday. Another edition of Storytime. We'll be there. We're working on a big-time guest. I just don't know if it's going to happen or not. So we'll keep that under wraps and see what happens. But until then, we will see you Thursday, everybody. Take care. Have a great afternoon, Yorkie and Bobby. Enjoy the course. Probably be there tomorrow morning.
Right, I'm going right back right now. I'll see you guys.
Me too, but I'm going for a dog walk on my golf course with my snowshoes. No. A little different than you.
I gotta go get some chipping and putting on. See you, gents.
You bastard.
See you guys.
See ya.
Coming in Hot is brought to you by Botano.ca. Please hit that like button and subscribe to our channel to never miss an episode.